and welcome to our panel discussions related to energy development. Today, four remarkable guests and our honorable president of Hiram College, Mr. Thomas Chimmel, will introduce us to the project, the topic of energy and how it's approached from multiple points of view. Our first guest is Dr. Luis Circio, who is the principal research scientist in the Electro-Optical Systems Laboratory at the Georgia Tech Research Institute, and he will discuss about the classification of waste and coal for energy. Our second guest for tonight is Dr. James Cortes, who is a senior policy researcher at the RAND Corporation, and he is involved in the RAND Environment, Energy, and Economic Development Program. He will discuss to us about the environmental and economical issues that are related to energy development. Our third guest is Mr. Thomas Hoffman. He is responsible for public and community relations for Council Energy. Hoffman is the company's chief communications officer to all external audiences and assists our department heads with internal communications. He will talk to us and present perspective from coal-related companies. Our last but not least guest is Mr. Schneiderman, whom our colleague will introduce into more depth in the next panel. He is the executive director of the Ohio Quality Development Authority and is leading air resources. He will present the policymaking from a technological, economical, and environmental point of view. And definitely our president, Thomas Chimmel, who has been having the honorable position, and we had the honor to have him as president since 2003. He's going to be the moderator of the panel. Thank you, everyone, and enjoy.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you all for joining us today in what I'm sure is going to be an opportunity for us to broaden our own horizons about energy policy, technology, the interface with the environment, the interface with economic development, and I wouldn't even be surprised if someone touches on national security at some point or another during the course of the discussions this afternoon. We at Hiram are very honored to have such a distinguished panel with us to participate in our Garfield Institute, and we welcome each of you to the dais here. As you probably know, the panels in the Garfield Institute are stimulated by the research work that our Garfield scholars do. The scholars help us recruit panelists. Not only do the introductions, but make sure that we have the kind of balance on the panels that are going to provide for lively and engaging opportunities. We've asked each of our speakers to spend about 15 minutes highlighting a particular area that is part of their niche in this overall energy matter. And then the panelists will, I suspect, have a few questions for each other. Because I think you will see some disparate points of view here. And then we hope that we will have time to take questions from the audience. And I know Professor Kortansky wants to make sure that the Garfield scholars have a chance to ask their questions, so please do not hesitate to do so. To get us started today, I would like to call upon Luis Circio, who is as introduced, is from Georgia Tech, and he is going to do the first presentation. Doctor?
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'm very pleased to be here, and I bring you greetings of Atlanta, Georgia, and Georgia Tech, and it looks like I brought an Atlanta Day here today. It's wonderful here. And being from Boston, Massachusetts, I'm not too, we really don't get days like this. This late in October, during Trump. I'm going to be talking about plasma technology and some of the research and commercialization that's been done over the years. I've been involved in plasma research since 1971, and at Georgia Tech, we started a plasma lab in 1990, and actually it's just recently, in the last several years, when plasma has actually been commercialized. The technology first got started with NASA back in the 1960s when a very high heat source to test heat shield materials. And once they developed, which I call modern plasma technology, this was transferred to steelmaking and the metallurgy industries, and around the world today it's pretty standard in those two industries. And it wasn't until the early 1990s when environmental engineers started looking at this very hot heat source and thinking that this is really very good for waste disposal and for waste to energy applications. And our work has mainly been in waste gasification with plasma, but also anything I say about waste would also be essentially applicable to coal gasification. And we have done some work with coal, and the company that I've been working with, which is Westinghouse Plasma Corporation and Alter NRG, a Canadian company, they have big interest in coal gasification also. I have a large collection of slides, but due to time constraints, I'll only be able to talk about the high points of many of these. But the entire briefing will be available online, plus a video which shows the actual gasification of waste materials would be available online. I encourage you to look at that, because I think this will give you a good idea as to what waste gasification looks like and the products and some of the benefits of this essentially new and emerging technology. I also have some slides from Alter NIG that I'm introducing into this briefing, because they're the ones that have really started commercialization of the technology, and they have even as of 2 weeks ago just opened a new demonstration plant to convert coal and biomass and eventually municipal waste to gasify it with plasma, put it into a biofermentation process, and produce ethanol. And I have a few slides on that also. So it's a very exciting technology, and it's we're just getting started with some of the very important applications. I'm going to start with a few slides here. It's for those of you that are not familiar with plasma, essentially plasma is often called the fourth state of matter. And if you heat a solid, you get a liquid. If you heat a liquid, you get a gas. If you heat a gas, you get a plasma. And plasma can be as benign as the fluorescent lights that we see in our ceilings all over this campus. And the new plasma TVs are, it can be as robust as a bolt of lightning as you see here. And this is the kind of plasma that we have developed, or NASA developed in the laboratory, which we have plasma torches right now for use in industry. So in other words, if we can get 2 to 3 feet of a bolt of lightning and put it at the end of one of our plasma torches, this is exactly what we're able to reproduce in the laboratory and in industry with the same temperatures and energy densities as we get in lightning. And the temperatures are three times hotter than any fossil fuel. This is very, very important for this new technology, and in fact, the temperatures are hotter than the surface of the sun. They range from 4,000 to over 7,000 degrees centigrade. At those high temperatures, we can virtually melt or gasify any earthly material, and that's why it's so much different than any fossil fuel, and it's about three times hotter than any fossil fuel. What do I point up here? I'm
plasma torch. And plasma torches run from anywhere from 100 kilowatts up to 200 megawatts. So we can get these power levels essentially as high as we want.
You want me to change that for you?
No, I can change it.
And this is a typical plasma flame. On the outside of the flame, the temperature is running around 4,000 degrees centigrade, and in the middle of the flame, they're running well over 7,000 degrees centigrade. And the important thing here is that the plasma torch operates with most gases. Air is the most common because it's cheap and all we need is air compressor. And it's a pyrolysis or gasification process. So it's essentially a melting or a gasification process, but it is not an incineration process, and this is very, very important. We use less than 10% of the air that's normally used for incineration to operate a plasma. And since it's not an incineration process, it's an electrical process, we're able to put these torches in boreholes, subterranean boreholes, and operate them underground in a coal field to produce syngas, and also in landfills, et cetera, to produce the syngas that we collect at the top of the hole, and we can process the same as syngas is produced in the normal plants. I'll be talking about that a little later. Now this is an important slide, and it shows the big difference from this technology to other technologies, fossil fuel technologies. At these very high temperatures, all hazardous and toxic compounds, and plus organic materials, are broken down to their basic elements, hydrogen, carbon, oxygen, et cetera, and then these recombine into simple acid gases, which are very easy to neutralize. And with organic materials such as coal or biomass or municipal waste, we're able to get a conversion into fuel gases, syngas, essentially hydrogen and carbon monoxide. And everything else, the inorganic material goes into a molten bath. It looks like a pool of lava, and you'll see this in the video online if you look at that. That hardens into a very, very hard rock, which is highly resistant to leaching, and it can be sold as a construction material. Is that working now?
Yeah.
Oh, good. So this is the overview of the technology. There's actually no other remediation technologies at these temperatures, or temperatures that come even close to what you can get out of a plasma. All known contaminants can be effectively treated or remediated with plasma. The only exception would be nuclear fuel rods, which you would not want to put into into a plasma system. And finally, any kind of contaminated soil or landfill deposits can be readily gasified into this lava mixture, and it hardens into a very hard rock-like material. And I'd like to show you what that looks like right here, and can be used as a construction material, and it's used in France is road gravel. It's used in Japan in concrete mixes and asphalt mixes. I'll just pass this around. Well, you could, I guess. Some people have done that. This is an alternate NIG slide, which actually shows
what this process looks like. And you can see when you put in any kind of waste coal, biomass, or petroleum coal, it goes into the system, and actually some air is added and a little bit of coke, and this is called the start-of-air process. The gas, when the gas is cooled and cleaned up, it's a very fine syn gas. In fact, it's cleaned as clean as natural gas. So it's a very safe gas. It's as safe as the gas you use in your gas stoves at home. And this can be used in gas stoves. And with that, once you get that syn gas, then you can make electricity out of it, or ethanol, like this plant that just opened, diesel, hydrogen, steam, and many other uses. I've seen the table showing something like 30 different applications once you get the syn gas. The slag material, the molten material, comes out and hardens into this rock-like material I mentioned, and is aggregated, used that as a construction material, so nothing goes to a landfill. This shows you the heating value, and one of the big advantages of plasma over fossil fuel systems. If we have 1 ton of MSW, it'll take about 0.12 megawatt hours of electricity to gasify this. We add the coke and air, as I mentioned, and if we look at the heat energy coming out of the system in both the syn gas and in the what you call a sensible heat, just the heat that's in the gases. And we put that over the heat and the electricity going in, we get close to 30 times the energy coming out of this system goes into the system. And I don't know of any other technology that'll give you this high a delta of energy out versus energy in. Now, if this was coal instead of MSW, this number would be around 55. So this technology would also be very, very applicable to coal gasification, and in fact, some projects for coal gasification are being developed right now. A study was done a couple of years ago by four of the largest companies in North America, environmental companies in North America, looking at how much electricity you get from municipal waste that goes to the grid with plasma versus other types of technologies. And they came up that plasma gasification would reduce between 20 and 50% more electricity to the grid than any of these other fluidized bed technology, the pyrolysis, or even incineration technology. And this is interesting because if you have an incinerator, we can get 50% more electricity to the grid with plasma than going into a plasma plant than it's going into an incinerator. And this is done with what you call steam turbine power generation. If we use this new technology they call combined cycle, we could get 50% more electricity, or about 1,200 kilowatt hours per ton. And since incineration can't use the combined cycle, we get over two times the electricity coming out of a plasma plant than you would get out of an incinerator. So this is very, very important in order to solve some of the big problems in incineration. This shows that since we're getting a lot more electricity to the grid, if we look at the amounts of CO2 greenhouse gases over the amount of electricity, when we have a plasma system, we get
the amount of CO2 or greenhouse gases that are very close to what you get out of natural gas, whereas for an incinerator, it's twice as much CO2 per megawatt hour produced. Coal, it's about 35% more and about 50% more for oil plants. So you see that the amount of greenhouse gas that we produce is a much less. And as a matter of fact, the Canadian study has said if you take a ton of municipal waste and send it to a plasma plant to make electricity and not send it to a landfill, the amount of CO2 that you save by not sending it to the landfill, the amount of CO2 you save by not sending it to the landfill, plus the amount of CO2 that you save by not having a coal-fired power plant produce that amount of electricity. This breaks down, and it's for every ton of MSW you send to a plasma plant, you save 2 tons of CO2 from going into the atmosphere. And I think that's very significant also. I may also point out, if this coal, this is a normal coal plant, if this was a plasma plant that we were gasifying the coal, then the CO2 from the coal plant would be about the same as what we get out of plasma MSW. This just shows the solid byproducts. You've seen the rock that we get. If that molten stream coming out of the plant goes into a water bath, we get sand. If there's a lot of metal, then we get metal nodules, and I have samples. I'll put them right up here afterwards if you want to look at them. But also, probably more important, if you take this molten stream and put it through a spinning machine, we could make a rock wool product out of that that's shown here. And this could be used as insulation. And this is essentially what that product looks like. And this is a better insulator than fiberglass. We can make it about 1/10 the price of fiberglass. And the next, I can't go into too much information here, but you can read this later. But 1,000-ton-a-day plant, a plasma plant of garbage, will produce 150 tons a day of this insulation material. If we sold this at half the price that fiberglass is selling for now in the Home Depots, we would still make $300 a ton in profit, $45,000 a day. And this is about what a plant operating costs are per day. So the tipping fees and the energy sales are all pure profits out of this plant. So you see we have a significant advantage by making this rock wool, or as we call it, plasma wool at Tech. We could get significant savings in the cost of insulation, significant savings in building energy requirements from buildings, and significant reduction in greenhouse gases because the homes are not using as much power. And also this plasma wool can be used in oil spill stabilization also. So we feel that that this technology can give us an ultimate disposal system. For these reasons, it will accept essentially all solid and liquid wastes. If it fits in the hopper, we can process it. It's a closed-loop system because the gases don't go directly to the atmosphere, and also you don't need landfills anymore. Instead of having landfill problems and landfill materials, we either make aggregate out of it for building construction, or we make this plasma wool product. And we have total waste reclamation, which I consider total recycling, and that we recover fuel value of the waste and produce saleable residues. Two commercial plants have been built and have been operating for 7 years now in Japan. This is a small one, which
processes municipal waste and sewage sludge in Japan. About 1 ton an hour reduces steam and hot water for local industries. This is a large plant, up to 300 tons a day of municipal waste. It also processes automobile shredder residue. And this will generate up to 7.9 megawatts of electricity, of which 4.3 megawatts goes to the grid. There's several projects that are underway right now in the United States. These four are with waste energy, and this one at that waste ethanol facility was just opened in Pennsylvania, and this is in Somerset, Massachusetts, where they're taking the front end off of a coal-fired power plant, and they're replacing it with a plasma system, and they expect significant benefits out of that. And if this works out as advertised, they're going to retrofit 300 coal plants in this country. And I have slides later on those two. In St. Lucie County, when they finish this project after the first two or three phases, this will process 3,000 tons a day of municipal waste. It'll have six gasifier units at 500 tons a day each. It'll produce 160 megawatts, of which 120 megawatts will go to the grid. And they're going to take the rock and use that as a construction material. Plus, nothing goes to landfill once again. People often say, well, this technology is too expensive. This slide shows what incinerators have cost in the last 15 years. Actually, these costs are 15 years old. This cost is the cost of that Tallahassee incinerator, that plasma plant I showed you in the previous slide, which is 1,000 tons a day, and it'll cost around $180 million. And we feel that if these costs were brought up to date, that they would be right in the middle of this. So we feel that a plasma plant would cost about the same as a waste energy incinerator plant right now. This is a way to cut that cost in half from $180 million to $90 million, and this is to associate a plasma plant processing waste, or it can process coal also, or waste coal, even high sulfur coal, with a coal-fired power plant, where we take the hot gases, or the syngas, and put them directly into the combustion chamber of the power plant, or we go one stage further, and we reduce steam and send the steam directly into the steam generator of the power plant. And we feel that we can replace an amount of coal on a 2-to-1 basis. In other words, if this was a 1,000-ton-a-day plant, we could replace something like 500 tons a day of coal. And we could get this plant at half cost, plus the operation and maintenance would be cut way down, because all these systems would be eliminated because they're duplicated up in the coal-fired power plant. And Georgia Tech has taken out a patent on this, and it's had a lot of interest. This is the plant that just opened on the 15th of October. And there were several articles out. The New York Times had an article on this. But this is taking, at least for right now, biomass feedstock, going into a plasma system and making syngas, then putting the syngas into a biofermentation process and producing ethanol. One of the articles that came out said that Coscada's process will produce ethanol from numerous feedstocks. They say any organic material. including wood, wood biomass, coal, municipal waste, agricultural waste, sustainable energy crops, and construction waste. It also says Coscata's technology will be able to reduce greenhouse gases by as much as 96% over conventional gasoline while using less than half the water it takes to get a gallon of gasoline. The company's ability to produce non-grain-based ethanol, that means no corn, is as much as seven times energy positive. So we would produce seven times the energy coming out of this process as it takes to perform the process. And one of the problems with corn ethanol is some people say it takes more energy to produce and grow the corn, et cetera, than the energy you get out of the process. So you see the big benefits of this particular application. This is the application from NRG Energy, which they're taking a plant in Massachusetts, in Somerset, Massachusetts, and knocking off the front end with plasma, and they said this is less costly than a new plant, and they have several good benefits to come out of this.
Doctor, one of the unfortunate things about being a moderator is that I've got to terminate very interesting input from our panelists. So I need for you to wrap up so we can get to
the questions. I was warned about the whole thing. I'll certainly do that. This just shows you that plasma is not too expensive. In fact, the capital, the expenses are less than nuclear plasma, incinerators, offshore wind, and solar energy. And this just shows you that you can actually put the torch on the ground, gasify coal material, oil wells, any kind of underground material, oil shale, tar sands, and catch the syngas at the top of the hole, and treat that and make energy out of it. And this shows you in the landfill how that would work. These just shows you a couple of plants that have been built around the world, maybe in the last 5 or 6 years or so. And the conclusions are that plasma has unique treatment capabilities, and this is important. It may be more cost effective to take garbage or any kind of waste material to a plasma plant than it is to dump it in the landfill. And plasma processing could reduce the MSW disposal problem, alleviate the energy crisis, reduce the need for landfills. And if we took all the municipal waste in this country and put it to a plasma plant, we could create 5% of the U.S. electricity needs, which is equal to about 25 nuclear power plants. And we could have this done before the first nuclear power plant, you know, is commissioned in this country. And this amount of renewable energy, which actually comes from EPA also, will produce more renewable energy than solar, wind, landfill gas, and geothermal energies combined. And that's the end of my briefing, and thank you very much.
Now we're going to sort of retreat a little from the cutting edge of technologies to talk about an energy source that has been around and been a staple for a long time. I don't think we can responsibly discuss energy policy without also talking a bit about coal. As a young child, I remember stoking, or helping my father stoke the furnace in our house with coal. Very few of us do that today, and so for many of us, coal doesn't seem very realistic as a fuel. However, coal is still the number one source of electricity in this country and continues to be an important source of economic value for many people. Tom Hoffman is with Consol of Pittsburgh, and I think we'll have an interesting perspective on an older technology and an older form of energy.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to say that our newest product was 250 million years in development. So it may not be cutting edge, but it's taken a long time to get to where we are. It is true that we've used coal for a long time, and in the Pittsburgh region, we've been mining coal since 1750. So this is a fuel on which the United States and indeed the world has depended on for centuries. And the thesis of my brief remarks before we get into the question and answer is that, like it or not, coal and the other fossil fuels are going to be around with us, and we are going to depend upon them for a long time to come. CONSOL Energy, some of you may know, is the successor company to Consolidation Coal Company in Ohio, and Coal Company, and we used to be fairly large operators in eastern Ohio. We don't have any operations currently in Ohio, but we operate in six states, and financially speaking, we're the second largest coal producer in the U.S. and the largest producer of tons of coal east of the Mississippi River. So we're a substantial producer of coal, and we are also a producer of natural gas, and in our case, uniquely primarily from coal bed methane. So we're taking a gas that historically had always been the enemy of the miner, taking that gas out of the coal seam prior to mining, using it, selling it into the pipeline, and then mining the coal and generating energy by burning coal. I think it's important to, the seminar is important because it is clearly timely for the next year, 2 years, 3 years. The United States and the world will be engaged in a discussion about energy policy, largely in the context of the environment, but not entirely. I think there will still be periods of time when we are discussing energy policy in terms of national security, in terms of world political stability. And so anything we talk about here today, I think, will be topics that will resonate for a number of years to come. If you think about it, the world depends on fossil fuels. 85% of the energy that we use in the United States, and roughly the same amount on a global basis, comes from coal, natural gas, and petroleum, and roughly equal amounts. And if you look at most of the forecast going forward, you see that world energy demand and U.S. energy demand are likely to grow by 45 to 55% over the next 20 years. And most of the estimates of where we will source that energy remain 85% fossil. And I'll talk about that in a little more detail in a moment, but we are very dependent on fossil energy. And so, as we debate policy issues surrounding the use of fossil fuels, not surprisingly, as a producer of fossil fuels, we believe that the policy debate needs to revolve around how do we continue to use these fuels on which we believe we will depend for decades to come. How do we use these fuels in a more environmentally acceptable way? So this, unlike, say, the Sierra Club, which takes one end of the environmental spectrum and says we need to simply obliterate the use of fossil fuels, particularly coal, we think the policy debate needs to be about how do we save fossil fuels like coal, because fossil fuels, frankly, are what the world has. Not only in the United States do we have huge reserves of fossil energy, particularly coal, but that's what we have around the world. And when you look at the pronouncements of large developing nations like China and India, what they say is we have coal and we intend to use it. So this is going to be a debate about not whether we should or shouldn't use coal, but in what fashion should we use coal? What fashion should we use fossil fuels? And I know there are a lot of people that say, well, could we not just substitute renewable energy? And it's an interesting proposition, but again, in the way in which we as a fossil fuel producer look at it. Let's look at the U.S. and look at just electricity demand. Electricity in the United States is generated with the three fuels, coal, natural gas, and nuclear fuel. And coal is roughly 48%, natural gas maybe 22%. So those two fossil fuels are 70% the way in which we generate electricity, and nuclear would add another 20, so now you're at 90. You get maybe 5 or 6 from hydroelectric power, and everything else is in that tiny sliver of the pie that's left. Of course, the two most popular things that we hear talked about are solar and wind, and while their growth in the last year has been nothing short of phenomenal, I think wind power has doubled in the amount of energy being generated from 2007 to 2008. Nevertheless, when you look at 2008, wind and solar together generated a little over 1% of U.S. electricity, slightly more than we get by burning wood. So these renewables, while promising and technically feasible, have a long way to go. There's a new issue of Scientific American out, in which two civil engineers from Stanford had opined that they could replace all of U.S. energy with solar and wind in 4 years. And they said, without batting an eye, it would only take $100 trillion worth of new investment. So it's a substantial hill that renewables have to climb in order to make a dent. I think a lot of people, and Jim's probably going to talk about this a little bit later, I think a lot of people looked at the energy scenario over the next, say, 20 years, think that solar and wind together could perhaps get 20% of electricity generation. That depends, of course, on building something on the order of 13 or 14,000 new miles of transmission lines to get the power from where the wind blows to where the people live. And I don't know how it is here in eastern Ohio, but in southwestern Pennsylvania, we have a fight on our hands when we try to build 100 miles of transmission line from one point to another, let alone 13,000 miles of new transmission lines. Now, this is not to say that renewables are something that I'm against. I think we're going to need all of the forms of available energy that we have, including gasification of coal and anything else that we can put our hands on. And there's a couple of reasons for this. There are probably 1.5 billion people around the world who today don't own a light bulb. They get from point A to point B by walking, riding a bike, or riding an animal. They heat and cook, burning wood or charcoal or animal dung. But these people have, I think, no less aspirations to live better than you and I do. And as they begin to be able to tap whatever energy they may have in their countries, they're going to expect to be able to use more. They're going to want to use the fossil fuels that they have as well as anything else that can generate energy. And that's why I think these developing countries have said, we are not going to turn our backs on the indigenous fuel we have, whether it's coal or natural gas or oil or whatever it may be. The other thing is, and another reason, are these things. The New York Times had a story several weeks ago in which they said that 15% now of household power demand on a global basis is because of gadgets. And I think in the U.S., for example, in 1970, all of us owned, on average, 4 gadgets. Now we own 20. I mean, I suspect there are a few of you here who have more than one television set. You may even have 2 in one room. And as our use of gadgets grows, the demand for power for those gadgets grows. And in fact, gadget demand is the fastest growing part of power demand in the residential sector, and it's expected to triple in the next 20 years. So we have demands for power that will need to be met. In my judgment, because energy is so interwoven into fabric of our lives, into a way in which we live, with the idea that, well, we'll simply conserve and not use as much, won't be a change in lifestyle that will come easily to many of us. I'm not saying it can't be done, but if we look at the way we live, we are inextricably linked to the use of energy. And in fact, study after study has shown that the use of energy is inextricably linked to longer longevity, lower infant mortalities, better nutrition, better education, better access to clean drinking water. The use of energy is, in fact, linked to a better way of life. And without the use of energy, as someone once said, life is brutal, harsh, and short. So energy is fundamental to the way we live. We believe that fossil energy is fundamental to the future of our country and indeed the world. And the policy debate is extremely important right now for this reason. Clearly we are debating coal in the environment and fossil fuels in the environment and the issue of carbon dioxide produced using the use coal and the other fossil fuels in the way we currently do. And we need to figure out a way to reduce those emissions of CO2. And as President Obama campaigned along with in a speech in which he said, this is America, we put a man on the moon, don't tell me we can't figure out a way to burn coal cleanly. And he was giving that speech in Illinois, and he, a senator from Illinois, pulled a recent statement. It's not a surprising campaign speech. But what he was saying is he believed that technology held the key to being able to continue to use the fossil fuels that we have in abundance in the U.S. I believe that too. The policy debate is going to revolve around one key thing, and that is, can we get our goals for emission reductions aligned with the ability to bring these technologies, which now exist at smaller scales, and can we bring these technologies up to commercialization and deployment in the same time frame as the desire to reduce the emissions? It doesn't do any good to proceed down a path to have a technology to remove carbon dioxide from the stream of gases that you get when you burn coal. If the technology is available in 2025, but the rules passed by Congress say you have to reduce the emissions in 2020. So this whole policy debate, this is where I'm going to wrap up, this whole policy debate that we're all about to be engaged in is going to be for coal, in the future of coal, a lot about aligning our ability to move technologies forward that will solve coal's problems and will allow us to continue to use the fuels with which we've been blessed and still meet the understandable desire that many have to reduce the carbon dioxide emissions that come from the use of these fossil fuels. And a lot of this is about the existing fleet of power plants. It's not so much about the new technologies that we will build in the future. I think everyone agrees that new power plants will be built with the technologies to capture carbon. The question is, what do we do about the 340 or so gigawatts of existing coal-fired power that generates nearly half our electricity? We have to have technologies that we can retrofit on those plants. And so this alignment between policy and technology, I think, is what this debate is all going to be about.
Thank you very much. Our next panelist, Jim Burtis, has a very interesting history because he was practicing this profession when we went through the last energy crisis. And I think it would be interesting to hear him talk about the policy perspective for the seat in RAND, but I would also hope that you might talk just a little bit about whether we've made any progress in the last 3 to 5 years since we did this before.
Thank you. I'll try to. the fact that I was around during that and acted during that last crisis is why they call me a senior researcher at Yale. With regard to Tom's closing remark, he mentioned 340 gigawatts of coal-fired power. That's almost $1 trillion worth of investments. So putting that aside, throwing that away is a lot of wealth. I'd like to back up a bit and then go forward and then maybe come back to Ohio. But if I don't get back to Ohio, I'm pulled off the stage. We can move back to the discussions. One of the energy problem as in its modern form, and I say in its modern form since 2000, really goes back to 73 with the Arab oil embargo, and it's always been embedded until very recently in terms of national security. And I'd like to make a few comments on what the national security issue is. It's often mentioned by people in Washington, which is where I live, to get our government to do something that it shouldn't be doing. And so if something doesn't make good economic sense, you can always say, well, it's a national security issue. There is a problem that we have with oil, and we just saw that problem manifest itself last year when oil prices went to $145 a barrel for a brief amount of time. And the problem is we have a cartel out there. And if they were operating in the United States, they'd be arrested and put in jail. But the international law allows them to do what they're doing, and they are controlling the price of oil. Or they're trying to. Does anyone remember what the price of oil was in 1985? It went down below $10 a barrel. Does anyone remember what the price of oil was in 1998? $10 a barrel. So we had about 17 years of very, very low oil prices, even though we had this powerful cartel. They weren't putting the price at $10. They had no choice. They couldn't stop the rest of the world from producing oil. And why did this happen? Well, after 1973, the price of oil went up by a factor of three, and then in the Iranian crisis of 1980, it went up again. And as a result of these price increases, companies around the world started drilling wells, looking for oil, and they found oil. And they found so much oil, and also consumers around the world started thinking about using less energy. And so cars, we have standards on automobiles, our cars became more efficient, we put insulation on our homes, we moved oil out of making electricity, we replaced it with coal. We have been doing the opposite for some years. And so we started demanding less oil. So this combination of less demand and a lot more production around the world, not under the control of OPEC, caused the price of oil to fall. I remember going to a meeting that was set up by the Central Intelligence Agency. We were worried about the stability of Saudi Arabia in 1998. It was so, prices were so low, they had cut their production so far back, that they were worried that the income coming into the country was enough to take care of all the U.S. special needs that brought up to that nation in terms of promoting stability. And there is some speculation that part of the problems of those periods, of those very low oil prices, was what may have spawned some of the reception that Al-Qaeda got as it started up then. Well, what happened? What happened is, remember the news coming out of Houston? Houston was a depressed area in the 1990s. I mean, people couldn't sell their homes because the oil industry had collapsed. So what happened for 17 years is oil prices were very low, and as a result, when oil prices are very low, people don't invest. When people don't invest, you don't get new production to replace that which is being used up. We had a very simple simple phenomenon is that why is pig butter? Pig bellies is still pork bellies is still up. You don't raise pigs. Okay? Price goes up, farmers raise pigs. Same thing goes up. Go out and accept it takes more than a year to get new production online. It takes about 7 or 8 years to get new production online. So as the price of oil started climbing in 2000, what we saw, 2002 actually, what we saw is a lot of companies started looking for new oil, and there was a tremendous amount going on at that time frame. And this oil is started coming into production, and if we did not have the economic tsunami that has that hit us last fall, it probably the oil market probably would have collapsed by now or maybe next year, because it takes that much time for this new production. Meanwhile, when these prices went up, everyone started cutting back. We were using more than 20 million barrels of oil a day. Now we use about 19 million. So the lesson here is that there is an economic a world market for oil. That market does work to some degree, but we do have this entity called OPEC, which is a very greedy entity. So instead of producing more oil, as we saw prices going up, they all said, "Oh boy, this is great. I'm going to cut all my production back," and that's why oil went up. Some of our own speculators boosted it up a bit more. And if OPEC were wise, it would have started producing more at around $60 or $70 a barrel to keep prices stable and not cost too much. Well, I really, we've looked farther into the future. We've asked ourselves, well, what's going to happen? Well, we're going to have an OPEC that's going to try to maximize its income. They don't know how. They're not well organized. Most of their members are not well behaved. They pump as much as they can. Notably, Venezuela and Iran, they need the money so much they never hold back the production. So OPEC's going to be trying to control prices. They're probably not going to be successful. What we're going to see instead is a lot of volatility as they go through these commodity market sequences. Meanwhile, when things are bad, Americans are going to pay a lot of money. Look at how much oil is in the world. We disagree greatly with those running around saying oil has peaked. It's almost as if they believe that that God plays tricks on us. I mean, come on. Resources like oil, you don't run out overnight. You don't run out of coal overnight. You're not going to run out of oil overnight. There's lots of resources out there. We took a look at the oil shale resource in Colorado, Utah, Wyoming. We found 800 billion barrels of oil are in place to that, are potentially recoverable, not in place, potentially recoverable. That's 3 times the oil of Saudi Arabia, and we think we can get it out for about $100 a barrel. So the prices stay high, there's lots of stuff we can use. We can take coal, we can convert coal into liquid fuels. And that comes, we think that comes up at less than $100. We can take biomass and convert it into liquid fuels. That comes out at about 100, maybe 120. So this future in which we're going to run out of liquid fuels is just not likely to happen. Now, that being said, if the big challenge is not the national security challenge, it's just the marketplace that doesn't function so well, and sometimes involves lots of dollars leaving our country. But if that's not the big challenge, what is? And what is the big challenge is what Tom was talking about. Well, how we address, I think, as how does the world and how will we in the United States put the most technically advanced country in the world, how are we going to address the problem of climate change? What are we going to do? The scenario I just painted, lots of oil, lots of sources of oil, is basically enough to toast the atmosphere. I mean, there's so much fuel out there that we burned it all, and the scientists are all correct, we're going to be living in a very warm world. Well, that's not going to happen. Countries around the world, especially the developing countries, but also the leadership certainly the intelligentsia of the developing world are all on board saying that we need to be doing something about clothing. That raises the dilemma for us, because as Tom pointed out, we don't have a great, a full bid, a full cover of technology, especially for the amount of power that we already have. Now, when it comes to global warming, people always point to coal. But petroleum use in the United States is about as much as coal, if not maybe a little bit more than coal. Except petroleum use occurs in your own use. And so it's hard to just capture it out back in. And there's lots of proposals being put forth. They include renewable power. They include the revival of nuclear power in the United States. The rest of the world, and there's this new technology that has that's being talked about, namely the sequestration or the storage of carbon dioxide emissions underground, and all of these, and then there's probably the most important, which is conservation. Can we use less energy? Slowly evolve or quickly evolve to a society that is not so dependent or less dependent on automobiles, changes the way it uses energy. My perspective on this, as I look at what's happening, is that we as a nation are not doing what we need to make progress. When I look, and then I want to go back to the challenge ahead of us, when I look at energy legislation over the last 30 years, it's not about energy, it's not about the country, it's really about special interest groups. And that's because there's a lot of money associated with energy. So we have a Congress that likes to tell people what to do, as opposed to set standards and goals. So for example, we have laws in place that say we have to use certain amount of alcohol and other fuels. Why is the Congress telling you what kind of fuel to use? We actually say that's the chemical, it's alcohol. We just said we want to make it. Now, why would they say that? Is there an energy security issue here? Well, most folks will say we don't save that much energy when we use alcohol. Is there a greenhouse gas issue or a climate change issue? Most folks will say, no, not when you grow corn to make the fuel. Because somewhere else in the world, the world's getting hungrier and hungrier because it's getting wealthier and wealthier. So there's always a need to have more agricultural production. So if you take corn out of production or any other, I don't mean to pick up just corn, it could be soybeans or anything else. If you take any food crop out of production in the food system and you move it over to the fuel system, somewhere someone else in the world is going to open a new field. And when they open that new field, there's a huge release of greenhouse gas. Because whatever was growing there is going to be gone. That's going to go up into the atmosphere, carbon dioxide. And then it turns out there's a lot of carbon dioxide, carbon in soil, to many feet below the soil. So researchers are recently saying that when you clear a new field, depending on the field, it could take years and years of biomass production to break even. And when I say years and years, if it's a rainforest, it's like 300 years. So if you clear an acre of a rainforest and grow some renewable crop, then burn it or make it into fuel, it's going to take 300 years. Well, no one is looking at the climate change issue. Now, that's extreme. Sometimes it takes 30. Sometimes, if you do it right, it can be no use. If you do it as a crop rotation, you do it on land that was recently removed, take it from municipal waste, forest waste, then there's no loss. So we've got a very complicated system before, and Congress doesn't seem to be approaching it in its complication. It's still approaching it in terms of interest groups. And the interest groups there are abundant. There are interest groups who have new technology. There are interest groups that represent every single fuel we have. Right now, we've got the coal group, they're asking for one thing, but if you had a natural gas representative here, he would be pushing natural gas. tell you how bad coal is and how wonderful natural gas is. And he would also tell you we have a tremendous amount of benefits, whether or not you really do. He would certainly prefer that there was plenty of natural gas in this country. So where are we? We have a Congress now that is deadlocked on what to do about global climate change. They are writing legislation that's thousands of pages, whatever Congress writes a bill, more of the bill that needs more of the special needs. Getting increasing. The last Energy Act was, you know, the leave no lobbyists behind one. And what we're getting right now, and I don't mean, and this, by the way, is bipartisan, both parties suffer from this disease. Very long bills, very complicated bills, it means that lots of loopholes and lots of money. It's our money that's going to be going to other people. And whether it solves the problem or not, I don't know. But I'm very skeptical. It's because of the history of our country in doing these things. They give their bills fancy names. And we also know that we can store another gas underground for millions of years because nature has already shown us that. That's called natural gas. So there's no doubt that it is technically feasible to do it, but we need to know how to do it. We need to know how to pick the site. And once we pick that site, not only do we know it, we need to understand what are the legal ramifications of doing this. No one's ever done this. So I decided I'm going to put it by the geology here is great. I'm going to put a bunch of wells in and start pumping CO2 in the ground. And you live a mile from my well. Does that mean I'm putting CO2 under your home? Even if it doesn't disturb it. Well, so far done, it's not going to hurt. Well, wait a minute, I own that land. What's my fee? Right? What's the liability of this group if that CO2, if the fellow was putting it into the ground? What's that person's liability if that CO2 is an earthquake and the CO2 is released? It's a liability if there's an earthquake and the CO2 is released and the earth someone suffocates. So I think there's a lot of law, a lot of public involvement that has to take place for lots of different disciplines. This is not an engineer's problem or a scientist's problem. This is a problem for all of society to figure out what to do, including the law. People who live in the vicinity of this. And if it happens where there's academic institutions involved, they need to take the leadership role in shaping the debate. So in my view, it's very important that it's done. It needs to be demonstrations in this vicinity. And on the other hand, I would say that the benefit doesn't come just to Ohio, it comes to the nation. So I would suggest that to the extent that someone wants to do this in Ohio, I'm hoping that they're not going to say it's for you to pay for, as opposed to, because we're really buying national insurance, this should be something that the federal government comes in on and shares the expense
of. Very, very interesting remarks, and thank you for reminding us at a liberal arts college that though we are not the engineers, that we're in the middle of this policy set of issues and debates. Our fourth panelist is a friend of many years who is in the fulcrum. He is in government, charged with responsibilities around clean air and water, quality of our lives, but he's also been appointed by the governor to be sort of energy czar. So we have a host of policy currents that you've heard some of float onto Mark Shanahan's desk every day. What do you have to tell us, Brad?
The energy czar title is really great, but I can't execute in prison anymore, so it takes all that. I think a couple of observations based on what you've already heard from this panel. And the first is that this is, in fact, an incredibly complicated problem. And I think that we need to sort of step back every now and then and recognize that, and to also recognize that despite all of our American trait of wanting to find a silver bullet, there is not a silver bullet answer to the energy challenges that we face, and we're going to need to look at many different sources. The combination of that and the complexity, I think, building on what Jim just said, I think that is an extremely difficult lift for legislative bodies. Really complicated issues are tough to write legislation around. Frankly, in the energy area in particular, one of the reasons I think that that's true is not the special interests, although they certainly play a role. Or I tend to think, if I think honestly about that, special interests for me tend to be the folks who get stuff out of legislation that I don't agree with. That's probably true for most of us. Those are special interests and they're bad. But I think the bottom line is a responsibility that we have to take on. It's a responsibility that things like the Garfield series that we do try to take on. And as on energy, our population is incredibly badly educated. People don't have a clue about energy. As long as they hit the switch and the light comes on, energy's good. There's not a problem. We've got what we need. Think about everything that in the early 80s, after we decided that the energy crisis was over, think about all the work that was being done on everything from synthetic gas from coal and coal slurry to a series of investments in renewable technologies that all just stopped dead in the water. Because the problem was solved. It wasn't going to come back again. And everybody who knew anything about energy knew that wasn't true. And they knew it was a cycle. They knew we had to look out into the future. But you know, I hear about gasification and synthetic gas and synthetic oil, as people talk about that now. And I know the folks at our Department of Natural Resources, when that became a hot topic, again, dragged out these file cabinets from the mid-1970s and dusted them off because all the research that was done was in there. Nobody looked at them since then. So we have a responsibility to educate voters about what the issues around energy are and to put in front of people the fact that they need to make some tough decisions too. That, in fact, there is a question they need to wrestle with. And that is this energy crisis just part of a natural cycle? Or because of climate change, is this one different? Do we have a different type of problem that we have to take on? And we can't just rely on the cycle to come back in and fix it all. So whether that's figuring out technologies that make the use of coal cleaner and specifically deal with the carbon dioxide problem. On over to, what stopped our presentation at the beginning? It was at battery. Batteries have been around forever. That shouldn't be a problem. Think about it now in your electric vehicle, and you're on the turnpike. Oh, I forgot to recharge the battery. Renewable energy has a serious problem. It can't be stored. We have to develop brand new battery technology in massive levels. That work has to get done. The technologies are out there, I think, to begin to address the complicated problem. One of the things I do is to take a look at people who have some of those technologies. And more recently, I've got to talk to a lot of folks because my office not only runs the Ohio Coal Development Office, which does clean coal technology research, but it also runs the state stimulus advanced energy program. We have about $150 million to spend over 3 years. And I do that, and the first thing I recognize there is that the legislature thinks they've given me an enormous amount of money to work with. And from a stewardship perspective, they're right, it is. But in the world of energy technology, $150 million is nothing. It doesn't get you anywhere. It's just the very beginning of the seed of a beginning. So it's expensive. The second thing that I've had, and this is sometimes maddening and sometimes exciting, because we have so many, I get to talk to folks everywhere, to present things to us everywhere from what you heard about them. About in our first presentation to three guys in the garage who have just figured out the solution to our energy problem, and they made it work at a 50-gallon drum. And they really think there's no reason the state should give $50 million to build a full-scale factory to start to produce it. And the scariest part about it when you leave the meeting is, maybe they're right. I don't know, maybe they have made the big breakthrough that we've all been looking for, but I know I can't give them $50 million to do that. So because this is part of a policy leadership series, let me just share with you some of the questions that we try to ask when these technologies walk in the door. The first one, obviously, is does it work and how do I know? Plasma artwork has been going on for years. You can take a look at years worth of laboratory testing, and pilot scale testing, and demonstration testing, and draw your own conclusion about whether or not it actually works. And having figured out it works, the next question is, well, how much does it cost? How expensive is it? Whether that's per megawatt or per gallon of fuel, what's it going to cost? And that leads you to the third kicker question, who's going to pay that? Are we going to try to socialize that cost? We socialize lots of costs in the United States today, but we describe it as that everyone's back gets up and says, that's not the American way to socialize costs. Everybody pays their own way as they go. That's not true in this country, but everybody thinks it is. And when you have a new technology and you want to talk about socializing costs, it really spins people up quickly, and that's a bipartisan reaction across the board. Who uses it? Who's this technology for? What's its scale? Is this power plant scale? Is this distributed energy technology that you can use at your home that solves a problem? So how much, who pays, and where will it get used? And how do we figure all that out before we try to deal with it? And then the final question, I think this is really an important thing that Jim touched on, although everybody really is, how long will it take? I mean, if you believe not the most pessimistic of the climate change experts, but those folks who are probably about three quarters of the way along that scale, we don't have a lot of time. Before the concentration of CO2 and its long life in the atmosphere get to the point of no return. So how do we begin to back away from that? And that really does come down to not only how long will it take the technology to get into the field, but what lifestyle choices are we willing to make that impact that? If in fact high use of electricity in a state like Ohio that gets 87% of its electricity from burning coal and produces 150 35 million tons of carbon dioxide every year just from our coal plants. If the one of the main ways to do that is conservation and efficiency, what are we willing to do? Most of us are not willing to pay First Energy's $21.60 for a compact or a pipeline. Maybe we're all willing to pay $4 for one. And buy it ourselves, then I don't need to vote, and use that. But those are choices we do have to make. Maybe we need to make a trade-off between high mileage in the vehicle and power. I live in Columbus. I'm always amazed how many Hummers are on the road in Columbus. And lots of them are in the upper Arlington, Hilliard, and Dublin, which are upper income suburbs. Not a lot of mountains. Their streets get cleaned of snow really quickly. So where are these folks use the Hummer? Where do they put that? Ability to go up a 45 degree angle at 40 miles an hour in the whole parking lot. And those are choices we need to make. And you know, as Jim pointed out, that you know, we sort of pride ourselves here that we let people make those choices. We can continue to do that, or we can continue to try to figure out different ways. Let me just conclude with one example. I think this is something of socialization that we don't think about. The largest user of liquid fuel in the United States is the Pentagon. Within that, the largest user is the Air Force. The Department of Defense today in Iraq and Afghanistan employs about 8 different types of fuel, each one specifically designed to work in certain vehicles and won't work in the others, with jet fuel being the highest quality. We bring in that oil into the United States from wherever we're buying, and a lot of it actually from the Middle East. We refine that oil here in the United States, the DOD controlled specifications. We make those 8 or 9 different types of fuel. And with heavy escort, we ship it back to the battlefield in Iraq or Afghanistan. And when that barrel of fuel gets delivered in the battlefield, it costs about $500 a barrel. Because of everything that it took to get there. That's led the Pentagon to start to talk about assured fuels. Can we figure out other fuels that we can use that are not partially dependent upon the whims of the folks who rule the countries where we happen to be fighting? And can be more secured so that it's not all done at coastal refineries in the United States, which are the toughest to protect from attack. Can we move into the internal United States where it's safer? Can we find other sources? Can we get creative? Some of those things they're talking about are taking coal and figuring out how to use that for liquid fuel, taking biomass and use that. A lot of that work is based on a technology that's old. It's a German technology that was invented in the 1920s, and it's a technology that powered a lot of the German military in World War II, and powered a lot of South Africa in the last days of apartheid. So it's a technology that doesn't have a really reputation for political reasons here. But it has some exciting potential. There's a small company in central Ohio, just outside Columbus, spun off of the Battelle Institute, that does something called micro-channel Fischer-Tropsch fuel well. This is basically a technology that can put on skids that can be lifted by Black Hawk helicopters, on 20 skids, a complete diesel production facility. And the micro-channel FT process can take the organic waste stream from a forward base camp and turn that into diesel fuel on site. An amazing technology. It's pretty expensive. It's not as expensive as $500 a barrel. It's being tested now. And as with many things like that, that will then evolve into civilian uses. But the bottom line here is there are a lot of technology solutions out there. The questions that we have to ask and then ask of our elected officials, those questions about having figured out what whether or not they work, is what's it going to cost, who's going to pay it, and how long is it going to take to deploy it. Let me end with just one story. About 2 months ago, we had the head of the the guy went through his presentation and he laid out what is a very typical development timeline targeted at the utility industry. He's been working on this for 5 to 8 years. He laid out a timeline of about 15 more to get to commercial scale. And that's not unusual. So Carl Bauer, who's the head of NETL, let him go through all that. He said, well, what would it take to do it in step? And the professor said, no, it would be too expensive. You can't do it. It would cost too much. And Bauer said, no, but how much would it cost? And he said, well, I didn't work that out. It just couldn't pay for that. The dean of the engineering college was dying. But this investigator, through four questions, could not figure out that what Bauer was asking him was, if we could make the money available, could you do it in half the time? It's because he was locked into how we do things today. And what Bauer finally said to him is, look, Secretary Chu looks at technologies in Japan that have gone from lab scale to commercial deployment with only a few years in between because they were prepared to take the risk based on their computer modeling and having confidence in that model. We never do that. We go through a whole pilot to demo the end. A lot of good reasons for that if you're a utility plant. But finally, the dean of engineering said, you know, professor, he's asking you, if he could give you the money today, how much would it take? And the guy said, well, I'll have to go back and figure that out. Bauer came back and said, well, you know, sometimes it's just hard to get money away. But I think the suggestion here is we really have to step back and rethink how we do things. If we believe that we're at a point that's different than the points in our history, and that climate change is indeed the challenge that scientists tell us it is, we have to rethink how we answer all those questions and how quickly we do it. It doesn't make it any easier. It doesn't deal with the special interests. But we have to have an educated public who can engage in that debate and push their elected officials in the right direction.
It causes us to want to scale and scope everything around a technological or other solution, as opposed to trying to divide this very complicated problem into pieces, parts, and then focusing substantial energy on each of the pieces, parts of the problem. Anyone would like to offer a thought?
Yeah, I'll take a shot. And by the way, I think it's not just that there's no silver bullet, but there's, I think one of the reasons that that was oversimplified, the fact that we don't have good energy legislation. One of the reasons is our Congress doesn't like to pass legislation which calls for sacrifice. And everyone would like, to find a technological solution to this problem. If there's some magic technology that lets us, or set of technologies that lets us go on just the way we've been going on, and at no greater cost. And there may be technology will help. New technology will help, but it's not the solution. So when you want to go beyond that and say, well, what do we really need? We really believe that it's a whole bunch of things that need to be done. And what we need are broad-based incentives. And since most of us believe in the market, in the marketplace, there are ways to put in broad-based incentives. And the Europeans have put tax on automotive fuel. And because of that tax on automotive fuel, their cars are far more efficient and they use much less gasoline. And also they have a very, very good rail system. And if you go to China, they're putting in 170-mile-an-hour trains in China. I went on the Shanghai Bank train. That's about 275 miles an hour. That's a little noisy, but because you're at ground level, the train is shaking. I mean, you're going at the same speed as an airplane. But I think that we need broad-based incentives, and we've got to come to that. And that means that we're going to probably need to rethink the way we raise money for government. Instead of raising it on income, maybe we need to move it more towards raising money on the energy extent to put carbon dioxide underground, use renewable fuels, we don't tell people to make that, we don't tell people we can put greenhouse gas emissions in the atmosphere, that's going to be an additional charge on that fuel. And you can't put that in overnight, because the entire, our entire society is based on, the way we behave is based on what costs are today. So you can't change things rapidly in one direction. You need to start in that direction.
I think the silver bullet problem is almost a problem of what we are as creatures. There's this tendency to want to have the answer. There's one way to solve this problem, and all we have to do is figure out what that is. So I'm perhaps a little more pessimistic. I certainly agree that we need the broadest menu of technologies that we can. If we've learned anything in the debate and the grappling with pollution from coal-fired power plants other than CO2, it is that all these power plants are different. Each one of them presents unique circumstances that require a technological fix that's somewhat different from the next one. But I think it's going to be a challenge. I think because of our nature, American Electric Power, I'm not picking on it because they're a great customer of ours. They dropped out of Future Gen because they had decided they had a technology they wanted to pursue, and we would have said, well, pursue that and stick with Future Gen. It's another way to take a bite out of the apple. But it just seems that our nature is that we want to focus our attention on one thing rather than focusing it on several. So I think it's going to be a challenge.
I think we undoubtedly have a number of people in the audience who are burning, no pun intended, with a question that they would like to ask cleanly. Who would like to ask the first question? Sir?
Complicated issue. Let me answer a complicated question. I'm mindful of the time conflict in this. You start with global warming and try to come to some approach to this. I'm reminded of Freon when we found out that it was Freon that did the ozone hole. We were years away from the Freon we just let go from having its threat. And I know that there's a guy in Antarctica today measuring that the ice is thinning. I suspect that molecule of 0.2 degree warmer water started 40 years ago somewhere and is being measured there today. 40 years from now, it's going to be 0.6 degree. This is a disaster scenario, potentially. You want a broad base of, is cap and trade, okay? Is that a tax on carbon, as I understand it? If I go to cap and trade, does that set off broad base incentives? Is that a positive forcing function for the broadest possible of alternatives like flash, coal gasification, et cetera? Is it worth it ecologically and economically? And 100 years from today, will that scientist in Antarctica be sitting there saying, the temperature didn't go up this year?
Without getting into a debate on the science of the issue, I think it's clear that one of the problems that we have as a public policy matter is we could eliminate CO2 emissions today in the U.S. And the fact is, 100 years from now, the globe would maybe be a tenth of a degree centigrade cooler than it might otherwise have been. And I think from a public policy standpoint, that may be a problem. We may impose these costs in one way or another, whether it's cap and trade or straight out carbon tax, and people are going to say, well, so that's going to end all of the unusual weather, and we'll have no more disastrous hurricanes and no more droughts. And of course, that's not going to happen. But I think that unfortunately, I think Jim is right. Congress can't help itself. It has to approach these problems from interest groups. And we're certainly at the table trying to protect our interest, as is everyone else. And we're going to end up with, I think, artificially chosen mandates that the structure that we're set up to deal with it won't be able to achieve. And we're going to be, I think what we'll likely end up with is a set of targets that when we actually get to them, we're going to say, well, we can't meet those, so we'll just have to go back and reset the target somewhat farther out or somewhat lower or higher, whatever the number is that we're talking about. I think the legislation is hopelessly complex, and who knows what results we'll get from it if it's passed.
I think beginning with the second question, I'll ask you to approach that microphone so that we can record it. Well, I think the acoustics are pretty good. We can probably hear the questions and the answers. We want to be able to record this too. So, second question at the microphone.
Hi, my name is Uday Pani. I'm a student here. I have three questions. The first one I'd like to direct to you, Mr. Cicero. You graduated from the Iowa State University with your PhD. I'm sure you're familiar with the Center of Agriculture and Rural Development. They post out a weekly ethanol operating margins and the historical and projected ethanol margins. And currently, from their last update on the 23rd of October, they projected that the ethanol margins under a dry mill ethanol plant are expected in coming years to deplete to the point to which they will go below break even. My question to you is that are these margins similar to the margins expected with your plasma arc gasification technology and those plants?
Yeah. Well, to tell you the truth, I'm not familiar with the actual Coscata process. It's still very proprietary. And the only thing that I've been able to find out about the process, you know, is the demonstration went on the 15th of October, is essentially the news release that they put out, a big article in the New York Times, and some other minor information that I've been able to get from a friend of mine who work at all the
time. My second question is for Mr. Bartlett. I cannot accurately remember your statement that you had stated that it would take about 300 years to put in a new renewable source into a new piece of land. I wanted to know if you are familiar with the plant name called Jatropha. It's a crop that grows very fast and is very common in Southeast Asia and India.
It doesn't. I was talking about the payback on the greenhouse gas deficit. I have studied Jatropha recently, as well as camelina, and I was in India recently and met with the senior energy leadership there, and they have planted, as you may be aware, I believe 100,000 acres of Jatropha. And Jatropha is one of those plants that is advertised as, it's a bush, it's a perennial, and it produces a false berry seed. The seed itself is poisonous. About 50 children a year die in India because of that seed. But the seed contains about 40% oil. So you can, if you take this seed, it's like olives, you take the seed, you squeeze it, and get an oil out of it. And the claim is that it grows on marginal land, it doesn't require any water, it doesn't require any fertilizer. So the Indians did it. They spent a lot of money on that. And the answer is what every farmer knows. You put crops on marginal land without fertilizer, without water, you get a lousy yield. Okay? The same claims are made with regard to camelina. And we have some camelina growing in Montana. The camelina growers will say the exact same thing. This is not displacing food. This is a wonderful crop. Well, that may be the case. We don't know. We have very little commercial experience. But we do know that when wheat prices went high last year, in spite of record high oil prices, camelina production in Montana plummeted. So I guess it means it's competing with wheat. So that's my. That's my story of those people.
Thank you. My last question is for all of you. As we all know, within the last year, there have been a lot of movements in the ethanol industry. One being, you could say it's strange to see a big oil refining company such as Valero make acquisitions on a lot of ethanol plants that bear some of their own. I believe they actually purchased six of the seven technical plants that were very important. I want to know what I personally see as the big major oil companies as the only ones with the economies of scale to actually make a shift into sustainable and commercially viable renewable technology. I want to know if you guys if you have seen more of this happening in the recent months, or if there is still a reluctance on the part of big oil companies to engage in developing such technologies.
Well, I can say that big oil companies would really like to get involved if they can find a way that's economic to do this. Exxon Mobil announced it was spending $600 million to develop algae-based fuels with that same company that what's his name, Vetter?
Yes,
Greg Vetter's company. They're looking at genetically modified algae. Or I don't even know when they finish, it won't be algae. So there's interest out there. I know that BP is looking at butanol, which looks a lot better than ethanol. And comes from the same kind of crops. But I think that the nice thing about biomass, if it's going to be used in energy, is that it is smaller scale, and large companies, it takes a lot of management expertise and talent to do small scale operations. And large companies try to stay away from that because they don't have that much executive talent to spread through.
No, it's true.
I mean, it's really true. People think that, talent, if you have good talent, you don't put it on a little project, you put it on something big. So, and there's a lot of community interaction with these small projects, so it's tough. That's why, just like when it comes to rentals, real estate, little people can do it. The same thing is true of the smaller projects.
One different aspect of your question, I think a mistake that we made in the 70s during the last iteration of this is we basically at the federal level precluded utility companies and the oil industry from getting involved in alternative energy opportunities. That was a very big mistake. We took out of the pipeline some of the best research, some of the most incented enterprises because we were afraid they were going to dominate. And I think it would be a mistake today to preclude big oil or anyone else who wants to get involved in these alternative opportunities from doing so.
Yeah, I'd like to say something about plasma too. With all the recent increase in interest in plasma technology for energy production, some of the big boys are starting to get into it now. For example, Waste Management recently signed a contract for a joint venture to use waste for energy production with a large plasma company on the West Coast.
Thank you very much.
My question is specifically directed toward Mr. Hoffman, and it refers to a couple of the comments you made earlier, the fact that you're a producer of fossil fuel technology. I kind of have issue with that term. Dinosaurs died 60 million years ago. That's why we have fossil fuel technology. You can be a producer of fossil fuel energy, but you can't be a producer of fossil fuels. And along with that, my question is mostly directed at the environmental section of your website. You talk about how now you're harvesting this methane gas that was previously released during the mining process, and carbon sequestration, one of the big advantages of it is oil leaching, will leach fields and getting more oil out of the ground, as you guys were talking about earlier. And I guess my question is, how is that leading toward more efficiency of conservation when you're just trying to use more of these forest resources? You're finding new ways to exploit the earth more, to use more of the earth. It's spending, it's deficit spending of the earth's resources.
Allow me to be blunt. It's not my job, it's your job. You want to conserve? serve. I can't pull a gun out here and say to you, Jim, or whatever the name is, go forward and serve. People don't demand my product. There's no reason for me to produce it, or whatever the right word is. I know what you mean. We do what we do, not because at the end of the day I take the coal that we mine and we divide it up and take it home in our lunch buckets and use it. I put it in barges and put it in railroad cars, put it in trucks, and I send it to a power company who uses it to generate the electricity that you use. And so long as you use electricity and the power company demands my product, I'm going to continue to produce it. Now, that said, we'd be foolish not to recognize that there is a desire on the part of the society in which we exist to deal with the emissions that come from the use of our product. And while we're not the ones creating those emissions, we certainly have a stake in seeing if we can't solve them. And in my company's case, we have several carbon capture and storage projects underway using a demonstrating right now in Pittsburgh a technology that was developed in Norway. We are capturing CO2 on a demonstration level, and we're growing algae with the CO2. The CO2 that is generated from power plants is way more than we can use, I think, in tertiary oil recovery. So we're going to have to store a lot of it in deep formations, and we are working at that. One of the things that we've done is to try and first take it out using identifying deep unminable coal seams, extract methane gas that's in the coal seam because of it as a fuel that we can use, and then sequester the carbon in that coal seam using the wells that we drill to take out the methane. So, I mean, our job is to extract, to provide these fuels that people say they want. The day that people say they don't want them anymore because they don't want to use so much energy is probably the day that we have to learn how to do something else. But as I said, we do what we do because people demand energy, and this is the way we generate it in the United States and indeed around the world.
I want to make a comment on your remarks too, because there's a real challenge, and no one at the table sort of sculpted for us. So I'm going to throw some numbers up. The consensus of the developed world, the world consensus that's growing is that we need to cut back global emissions of carbon dioxide by a factor of 2 by 2050. Now, given that the developing world is putting up, is growing, to make space for them to have some development, that generally means that the United States has to cut back by about 80%. Putting some of this, continuing to use coal and putting some of that coal in the ground is one way to get there. But putting some of the carbon dioxide in the ground is one way to get there. But we are talking about a massive change in the way our society uses energy. And it's not going to be met just by conservation, and it's not going to be met just by renewables. In fact, it's very hard. We've done analyses. The 25-25 Coalition came to RAND and asked us to look at 25% renewables in 2025. And of course, renewables. If the reason we're doing this is to cut back on greenhouse gas emissions, renewables are not the way to go, not that much. Okay? But that means that we really need to think about efficiency, we need to think about putting these signals into our economic system so that we properly, make the right moves. This is a massive change.
To underscore how big that job is, to reduce U.S. emissions by 80% by 2050, taking into account our projected population growth by 2050. The per capita CO2 levels that we would have to be at, we haven't been at since 1910. And today are only being met by underdeveloped countries like Somalia and Belize. So it is a very, it is a huge change from where we are. And Jim's right, it's going to take a whole lot of efforts on a number of fronts if we have any hope of getting.
I guess as a follow-up question then would be, if coal has been in existence since 1779, you said it's been mined in Pittsburgh since 1750, why now? Why carbon sequestration now? Why?
You didn't, like, you, 20 years ago, you didn't want that. You didn't ask. I mean, we're a public service company, in fact. I mine this coal, I give it to somebody else, they use it. There was no, the CO2 issue has really only emerged in the last decade and a half. Just as, I mean, and Pittsburgh is a terrific example. I mean, we still suffer under the image of Pittsburgh from the 50s where it was so dark at noon that the street lights were on and men changed their collars on their white shirts a couple times a day because it was so gritty. But we didn't care back then. We didn't demand of our industries that they deal with that issue. As we have, if you look at what we've demanded of our coal-burning utilities thus far, for the pollutants that they have been asked to control, they've spent billions, and they've reduced that pollution level by 40%, even while coal demand and coal use has gone up probably by 50%. They've done it because they invested in technology to do it. CO2 is relatively new. I mean, after all, it's what you and I exhale with every breath. So it's not a toxic gas. And it's only been recently that we have focused on it as an issue about which we need to cope. And I think we'll cope with it. I think we'll deal with it from a technology basis. But it's relatively new, and that's why we haven't done anything about it.
If I could just jump in with two things there. I think this theme of, you know, you get what you want sort of re-emphasizes the need for education and understanding what it is that you want and what the implications of that are. The second observation would be, I think it would be a really interesting study. Some of these have been done, but how many times do you hear that from the coal producer, the oil producer, the low-mileage car producer, that we only give you what you want? If you didn't want this, we wouldn't even make it. And then they spend hundreds of billions of dollars advertising to tell us that that's what we want. I think those two are interesting. They're both true. Think about all the, clean coal is your future ads you've seen. And the ones that make fun of the coal technology. That marketing has an impact on what we think and how we approach these issues. So CO2, you didn't want us to clean up CO2. Right, 20 years ago, nobody thought CO2 was a big problem. Science has moved on from that. So now, yes, this you wants us to fix CO2, and we will. Let me just, a direct example for Ohio. In the 70s and 80s, there was growing evidence about about acid rain, the effect of sulfur dioxide emissions from coal-burning power plants. Until 1983, long after the science had left the building, Ohio's official position was acid rain does not exist. We don't know what's happened to those trees and those lakes, but it's not acid rain because that's not real. In 83, we took the huge step forward of saying, okay, there is acid rain, but we didn't do it. We don't know where it's coming from, but it's not us, so don't blame us. And finally, when the 1990 Clean Air Act amendments got passed, nobody wanted to talk to us when they wrote the rules about how to regulate SO2 emissions. And Ohio paid a very steep economic price for that. But I think it's really incumbent on all of us to make sure that the folks who make these policy decisions are getting feedback from an informed public, and not just informed by the ads that they see on TV, but a much more valid basis of knowledge to tell them what it is we do want, and why we want that, and then push it forward on that basis.
Thank you. Good responses to an interesting set of questions. Philip, you get the last one.
now, as you mentioned, we don't know how to sequester this carbon dioxide. And my question is right now, if we can't figure out how to contain the solid nuclear waste in the mountain, how are we going to contain the CO2 in gas or feasibly liquid form? And if we do figure out a way, I imagine it's probably going to cost a lot of money to set forth this new effort. What in building this infrastructure, transporting the CO2 to these reservoirs of CO2, what is the push to move towards that and spend the money on that infrastructure as opposed to infrastructure for new renewable energy and transporting the renewable energy to where it needs to go?
Well, I'll start by saying I don't know that I'd agree that we don't know how to do it. I don't know that we know how to do it on the scale that we need to. Pennsylvania, as an example, is looking at the concept of central sequestration for, and currently evaluating a number of geologic sites in the state that can be used to serve a number of power plants in an area, as opposed to having every single source of CO2 have its own sequestration site. So I think we will look at things like that as sites, and I think it's estimated that we've got in the U.S. probably enough geologic formations that can sequester carbon to last just 1,000 years. But we need to understand what happens when we do it. That's what the work that's going on now is, to follow the migration of the CO2 once it's in the ground to see if it in fact stays where we intend for it to stay. And as we were talking earlier, we're going to have to work out a lot of the legal framework under which you do these things. But we're talking about the existing fleet power plants and the $1 trillion of investment and the 50% of your electricity that comes from those power plants that generate CO2. And so while we need to invest in power lines to get wind power to where it's needed, we're going to have to invest in this infrastructure because we're dependent on this existing way in which we generate electricity. So we've got to deal with that problem as well.
Thank you very much. Mark is going to get another opportunity to talk with those of us who are having dinner together this evening. But to conclude, I'd like to ask our other three panelists if they would like to say anything by way of concluding remarks. Doctor, any thoughts?
I'm good. I have the last word.
Jim?
You asked me to speak just before dinner?
Yes.
No.